From the heart of Silicon Valley in California, this is Plug-In 2008, and you've got an exclusive press pass. Welcome to the media room here at the 2008 Plug-In Conference, and you can tell it's the media room because of two things. First, there's food in the back, and you always have to have food in the media room. And second, you've got journalists here, just like the famous Del Coates, who used to be a car designer and now is a legendary journalist and author and attendee here. And Del, my first question is, we've been here for 3 days. What really sticks out in your mind as some information that you didn't know 3 days ago?
Well, first of all, a very general lesson. I think this conference is a marker, in effect, for the tipping point or when we meet, when we reach critical mass. The whole electric car thing, electricity as fuel thing. I was in the electric car business back in the late 60s, a little startup firm in Detroit. And of course, it was just lead-acid batteries in those days. And really, the industry at that time was a bunch of amateurs. I mean, and in the literal sense, amateur meaning to love something. Enthusiasts. And there were token efforts going on at all the car companies. I mean, GM and Ford, at least, I knew had electric car efforts going on. But it wasn't very intense. And so you go to a conference like this, and it's a bunch of what look like hobbyists. They're converting cars, taking the engines out and putting batteries in. And not much interest from the industry or investors, interest from the electric utilities. They, in fact, were quite supportive. Not with a whole lot of money, but some. And then it went, and in the 60s it was, the solution to environmental problems. And then in the 70s, early 70s with the Arab oil embargo and the rise in fuel prices, it became an answer to the fuel crisis. But it didn't seem to attract very much attention. I mean, it was kind of a novelty thing. But I think what really became an important catalyst, of course, were the hybrids. Honda and Toyota, coming out with those hybrids in the late 90s. That was an important kick in the pants,
I mean, gas prices were approaching $2.
Right. But $4 really is, I guess, what it took. It was coincidental that this conference was planned for that time, and the result is that on rather short notice, we got 650 registrants to this conference, people from all technical walks of life who were interested in it, and a lot of industry interest now.
100 media people.
Oh yeah.
And on the public night, 1,000 people.
Yeah, that's fantastic. But there are industry and the utilities and the electric car thing, that community, the green community that has sprung up. They're all working together now. The Prius has become sort of the poster child of the whole thing, and it's so adaptable to these retro battery packs, where you can plug them in, and run anywhere from 10 to 40 miles on total electric power. So they're essentially an electric car at that point, and you're paying for electricity as fuel instead of gasoline while you're doing that.
What I came away with too was the fact that many speakers said, We've got to work together. The utilities mm-hmm. have to work with the car companies. There has to be some sort of standardization, or this whole yeah. scenario could just really bog down.
Yeah, and that's new too. I mean, that well, you know, if you talk to people who've been involved in this for a long time, you'll find it's not entirely new. But what's happened now is, you know, it's reached that tipping point, you know,
yeah.
And you know, the gas prices probably are more responsible for it than anything at this particular point in time. But, you know, again, these enthusiasts have been showing that you can plug in a hybrid, you can put additional batteries in it and really extend its range. I mean, they're all talking about 100 mile per gallon plus. The standardization issue, which you bring up, you know, there was this big concern back in the early 90s when the GM EV1 came out, and you know, there was the Toyota RAV and so on. You know, the argument between whether it's going to be a plug, just an ordinary conductive plug, like you plug in any appliance, or whether it's going to be an inductive connection like General Motors had, which reduces the shock hazard, you know, because it's not a direct electrical connection. You can't have both if you're going to have parking meters with charging plugs in them. You got to choose one or the other. And I really like the idea of the standardization going even further, so that instead of this wide variety of battery formats they now have, you know, everything from cylinders that look like flashlight batteries to real flat batteries. It would be nice if there was a higher degree of standardization there, so that when a consumer wanted to replace his battery, not necessarily because it's worn out, but because he wants to upgrade his car, you know, he might be able to buy a battery that has twice the energy storage capacity that his original battery did. So it would be nice if there was a plug-and-play capability, you know, like a lot of things are.
Yeah. Or like as in Israel, where a company decided to swap batteries with you on the road. You drive into a station, swap the battery, get a fresh one, and go.
Right.
You know, there needs to be some sort of standardization.
Yeah. So
you mentioned mm-hmm. A little bit of the safety thing, and I when they mm-hmm. took questions from the audience, one lady stood up and said, "Well, what about the electromagnetic the disturbances on the body?" And that was an issue that I hadn't heard at all during this entire conference. So, do you think that's a real issue? Or?
There was a lot of discussion about safety, in all fairness, but it had to do primarily with this runaway heating problem with you know, the lithium-ion batteries. Just this morning, I think I read about the concern of cell phones, you know, and doctors are warning people not to let kids have cell phones, maybe, and to not put them up to your head too much. There's still some concern about that. And I heard some rumblings months ago about electric fields and hybrid and electric cars, but I haven't heard anything about it. I don't know if there's any hard evidence of that or not, but sure, we've got to be concerned about it. I mean, obviously.
Okay, from a pure consumer vehicle mm-hmm. standpoint, if I've got a dumb SUV in my car, SUV in my driveway, mm-hmm. and I'm looking to get rid of it, this is probably not the best time to do that.
No.
But should I wait? Should I try to get into a hybrid right now? What do you think?
Well, with the next generation of them so close, I mean, you know, the next generation Prius is, I mean, that still seems to fluctuate, but I guess it's going to be a 2010 model. And of course, Honda's coming out with a new one, which they refer to in-house as the Prius killer. And I think both of those, neither of those will be plug-ins. You know, they'll. In fact, I think they might both have the nickel metal hydride batteries. A number of others. I mean, I've been driving an Altima hybrid this week, and I'm quite impressed. You know, it's a very snappy car. In fact, it feels a lot like a V6. At any rate, you know, I'm on my second Prius. I had a first generation, second generation. I can't wait to buy my next hybrid. I mean, my mindset is on Prius right now, but it could be, you know, I think I'm going to have more choices.
How does your wife feel?
Oh, she loves it. I mean, she really claims the car as her own. You know, that's her car.
Yeah.
And when I went home after the first day of the conference here and told her about the plug-in adaptations, you know, which can cost $10,000 or $11,000, she was gung-ho. Uh-oh. I mean, she wanted one.
Uh-oh. And, Bill, you got to be careful what you say.
That's
it could
right.
come back
that's
to
right.
haunt you.
Yeah. So anyway, I will definitely, there's definitely something in my future, near future, I'll have something else. But I want to, on this point, you know, I wish they wouldn't just think of hybrids as economy cars. Because what comes along with that assumption is, that, well, you're not, the, you know, the buyer of this car isn't particularly interested in performance or handling or, you know, and that isn't true. I mean, in my case, and I have a feeling it's not true in the case of a lot of hybrid buyers. I think there are guys like me that wish it would handle like a BMW, and I don't need I'd like a little more acceleration.
Okay.
But you know, it's a delight, and I'm speaking of the Prius now, it's a delight to own because it is a marvelous car. It's marvelous technology. But I wish it had steering and handling at least as good as a Civic Si. And that isn't asking for a lot in terms of money. I mean, they can afford to do it. And
it does have the aerodynamics.
Oh yeah, and that's one of the reasons I really love the thing, because you know I taught car design for 30 years, and I've always been a nut on aero, and so I would always introduce my students to aero before they did anything, and so I'm drawing the ideal aero car on the blackboard. And it's a Prius. I mean, I'm talking about going back to 1965.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, they knew what the ideal form was. In fact, Citroën was doing things like that. And in fact, if you drive along sort of to the rear of a Prius, it looks a lot like some Citroëns of the 70s.
Okay.
And
I just thought it was one of your Japanese students who took your chalkboard.
Well, he wasn't a student of mine. I wish I could claim that, but when I saw pictures of it, I had to have one. I mean, there was just no question, because it's classic. I mean, it, and you know, it's got the best CD on the road. I mean, 0.26, that's as good as Citroën's ever done. In fact, probably better. The best I ever remember Citroën doing is about 2.7. And incidentally, I'm glad you brought that up, because I think that we're going to see a new aero age.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, good aerodynamics is the absolutely cheapest way to increase fuel economy.
Absolutely.
In a car. Because all you're doing is changing shape. Now, you know, you run into snags because people are wedded to existing forms, like when the Insight comes out with skirts. It really revolts people. And it's hard, it's hard to believe that not long ago, just a few decades ago, skirts were kind of standard issue.
Yeah.
You know, the Jaguar we all fell in love with first, you know, the XK120 had skirts.
Yeah.
And it's you know, when you push the envelope on aerodynamics, you often, well, a lot of people don't like the Prius. And it's because of that shape.
Yeah. Well, they just have to get in and drive it.
Well, that's right. I mean, that's my feeling. And yeah. And I the same for the Insight. I mean, I thought that was a beautiful car. My students, gagged.
Yeah. Well, Del, I think we've kind of run this through.
Okay.
It's been an interesting 3 days, and I certainly invite anyone who's watching mm-hmm. this to check out a lot of the clips that we have on of the speakers and the events. Mm-hmm. It does look like we're entering a kind of a brave new electric world.
Very exciting.
But as media members, now that they've taken away the food, I guess we ought to get out of
here. Yes, it's time to go.
All right.